Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the second of the Hello World series. In this series, we look at a different system each time, and we create a basic Hello World on the screen in the simplest way possible. And this is the idea of this is that you can make a simple program and get started really easily, and then you can use that and make whatever you want out of it, and don't necessarily need to follow the more complex tutorials that I've covered. Anyway, this time we're going to be looking at the Commodore 64. We're going to learn how to make Hello World on the Commodore 64 as a PRG file and also as a cartridge. So hopefully that will be interesting to you, depending on how you're looking to start going. Anyway, let's have a look at the code and let's see it in action. So here's the code we're going to be running today. And let's just start it up. Let's start it on the C64 here. So you can see we've just started from basic here and we've shown Hello World to the screen and then returned back to basic. So that's very straightforward. So how has this actually worked? Well, we're using the system call of FFD2 to print a character to the screen. Now, this is a little bit tricky because the Commodore 64 doesn't use standard ASCII and my assembler does. So what I'm doing is I'm converting the character codes. The way I'm doing this is I'm checking if the character is above 96. And if it is, then I'm having to set bit 5 here to 0, and that will basically fix the character codes for the purposes of basic text. So that's how we're printing characters to the screen. But when it comes to printing a string to the screen, I'm extending that print character routine with a common print string routine that I use in all of my tutorials just here. My tutorials use a character 255 terminated string. You can see it just here. We're loading in the address of the string into zero page entries 20 and 21 here, and that's how we are getting it in ready. And then we're printing it to the screen here, one character at a time, using Y as a counter until we get to that 255. I've also got a new line command here. I'm using character 13 printed to the screen. That will start a new line on the Commodore 64, so that's pretty straightforward. Now, that's how we can print our Hello World, but before that, of course, we actually need to create a valid program. And we're using a PRG file in this example. A PRG is a sort of basic program that we can run, but it needs a header. And you can see we've got that header just here. Now, we're not going to go into the details of this. Essentially, this header will start as at 0810, and that is going to be a good place for our program to start. So that's what I would suggest you use as a sort of template if you're looking to create a PRG file. Now, if you're creating a PRG file, this is the code you need to use, but of course, you're going to need to actually assemble that. Now, I assemble with a batch file. You can see this batch file just here. And you can see I'm using VASM in old style mode just here. Now, when this starts, I am specifying the assembly file just here, the ASM file. And you can see there's a switch, CBMProg, which tells VASM to create a PRG file for the C64. It actually understands that format, so we tell it on the command line here. We're also telling it to check labels. This means that if a label looks like a command, then it will warn us. Now, this often happens if you've got a return command or something and you forgot to put a tab in, so it's at the far left. It will be mistaken for a label and it will cause you problems. So I'd certainly suggest you do that. I disable case sensitivity with this no case command. I specify to output a listing file. That's a big help because if you have problems, the listing file will show what each line is compiling to. So that is a good way of learning things and also learning about how assembly is actually working under the hood as well. I specify a symbol for VASM equals 1. Sometimes if I'm using multiple assemblers, I need that, but you don't need it for this example. I'm defining a build C64 label. The one you just saw, you won't need that. The more advanced one, you might need it though. So it's up to you. We're going to look at the more advanced one in just a moment. Finally, we're defining a binary file and we're outputting to a file name called build c64program.prg just here. So that's how we're actually specifying the destination file name. If that completes okay, there's no errors, then we just start vice with the x64 command and specify the PRG file that we just built on the command line, and that will start it up. And that's what you saw getting the emulator running today. So that's how we create a PRG file, very straightforward. Now, PRGs are great to get started, but if you're looking to do a lot of stuff with the screen memory and you need a lot of RAM, you might want to consider using a cartridge instead. So how can we create a cartridge? It's a bit of a pain, but it's not too bad. I've got a simple example just here. Now, the program code at this point is basically the same. The only bit that has changed is this part here. Firstly, we've got a kind of fixed header, which I would suggest you don't worry about changing at this point. This will create a valid cartridge header for your program here. But then we need to do a little bit of work. You see, the cartridge starts up without basic. Previous example had basic already had run and done some work for us, but now we're doing it all ourselves. So we've got to do some of the jobs basic was doing before our program can run. we need to initialize the IO with this function call here. Enable the RAM, clear the memory. We need to set up the vector table and we need to initialize the screen. So we run these commands and then it's almost as if BASIC has run for us. So if we compile this, we can see it. Now, I can't use the same batch file we just saw. I need a slightly different one. So if I select this batch file here, hello world, and you can see there's no BASIC introduction screen here because BASIC never ran. So as I say, that's the disadvantage, if you will. But now we've got all of the RAM in the system, all the addresses in the low area. Our program's running at a higher address at 8,000, so that might be more convenient for you, just depending on what your game is doing. So there we go. Now the question is, of course, how do we assemble that? Because we can't assemble that in the same way as we did with the PRG. So let's see the batch file that I used to assemble this today. So here it is. It's not too different from the other one. The most of the command line is exactly the same here, but there's no CBM PRG option here because we're not building a program anymore. We're building a cartridge and we're specifying our own header. Now you can see we're outputting to a program called program.crt. That's the cartridge file. Now the only thing we need to do differently on top of that is I'm padding the cartridge out. I'm having to pad it out to 16 kilobytes. I'm using a program called Binary Tools. This is something I wrote myself. All of these programs that I use and these scripts are available in my downloads on my website, so please go and have a look at that. But Binary Tools is a C# program that does little tasks that you often need to do when building cartridges for emulators and things. And in this case, we're filling out all of the bytes here to the 16K boundary. Now, once we've done that, our cartridge is ready to run. We're using Vice again. We're specifying cartridge CRT format, and we're specifying the program we just assembled and padded out just there. So that's all we need to do to get a cartridge running. So there we go. Now we've seen the hello world both from PRG and from cartridge, but there is another thing I want to show you today. Now getting hello world to the screen is most of the challenge of learning a new system in some ways. And once you've done that, you can really start to learn more about the hardware and figure out what it is you really want to do. You know, once you can get text on the screen, you can start working out how to enable the graphics mode, for example. Now, what I do when I'm starting with a new system is I use some monitor tools. I've written my own simple monitor, one to show the registers to the screen and one to show bits of memory to the screen. And this really helps me out when it comes to figuring out how the hardware is working and just getting things started. Because if I can see the state of registers, I can read in for hardware and then see those values to the screen. Or if my program's malfunctioning, I might need to check the zero page entries or see that parts of the program memory haven't got corrupted. And being able to dump memory areas is good for that. So I'm using the monitor function here, and that will show the registers to the screen. And I'm using memdump, and that will dump a memory address and a number of lines to the screen. And if we just run that now, I'll just specify PRG again. You can see we've got the registers here, A, X, Y, the stack, the flags, and the program counter here. And we've got the memory address 3000, which has nothing in it, rather disappointingly. Now, if I change this from 3000 to 800 though, and run again, well, you can now see that we've dumped our actual program code to screen just here. Now, we've looked at how to create this program and show the hello world, but there is a problem you might have noticed. Our hello world here is in uppercase, but if I look at the program code, it was supposed to be in lowercase. And this is the problem with the ASCII that we're used to using, not matching what the C64 uses. Now, there is a way we can gain the lowercase if that's something we need. Now, the routine I was using before was to compare to 96 and changing the bit 5 to 0 here, and that would basically strip out the lowercase. But if we send a special control code to the hardware, we can actually enable some lowercase characters, although it's still not ASCII, it's still a different code set. So if I just rem this out here and I just unrem this here and now I compile, you can see our formula here for converting the characters is different. Now, when that control code hit the system, you can see that all of the characters became lowercase, but now my H and my W are uppercase. So you have this alternate font if you want to have upper and lowercase. The advantage, I believe, of the other one is that it's got more graphics characters. So this one is really using all standard characters, but you'd lose some of the graphics characters. But it just depends what you're doing and what kind of design appearance you want. If you're doing a text inventory, you want a lot of text, you probably want that lowercase, but the uppercase is probably enough if your game's more an action game. So anyway, there we go. So we've seen a couple of different options there. We've learned how to build programs and cartridges. We've seen a basic Hello World, how to do different character style, and also how to do the monitor tools, which, as I say, is going to really help you out. Now, if you want to go your own way here and just learn how to do things yourself, just from that Hello World, of course, you're welcome to do so. If you want to see more C64 stuff, I've got a whole range of C64 tutorials already covered on my website, and so please have a look at my YouTube channel and see the other C64 content. Anyway, if you've enjoyed this, please like and subscribe, because it really helps with my motivation of doing these videos. They take a lot of time, as I'm sure you can guess. There's going to be more C64 content coming, though. I'm going to be doing the Super Simple series from here, which is a bit like Hello World, where we do very basic examples, and we're going to be learning how to create a bitmap on the screen and read in input in the simplest way possible, so please stick around for that as well. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this, and I hope you enjoy programming the C64. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.